Hello?
Hello, Fiona. Sir Alan wants to see you in the boardroom in an hour.
Right. He's a successful businessman and a household name. But do we really know Sir Alan Sugar?
I can only describe Alan as terrifying.
Just can't stand bullshitters.
Very blunt, very straightforward.
But some of his views, I think, go back to the Stone Age.
Tough, isn't it? Whether it brings in any bloody money is another story.
I've been given unprecedented access to Sir Alan's private world.
That action pulls us back. And this one pushes us down.
I'll be finding out how he built a billion-pound empire, bringing computers to every high street.
There's no rocket science in this computer stuff, right? And that, I think, is why we were so successful, because of that philosophy.
It's just a pity we haven't got more people like him in Britain.
But after great success, Sir Alan's electronics empire fell apart.
It dealt a very deep wound to Amstrad, from which really never recovered. CSE was very deeply affected by it.
Sir Alan's closest family talk for the first time.
He just came home one day and said to me, I've bought Tottenham Hotspur. I went mad.
At work and at home, I'll be meeting the real Sir Alan.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Sir Alan.
I'd imagined my first meeting with Sir Alan would be like something from the world of The Apprentice. But that was only in my dreams. The reality was the 9:13 from Liverpool Street.
That's like glamorous, is it?
My destination, Brentwood in Essex. In the real world, this unlikely office block is Sugar's headquarters.
Hello, Fiona.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah. How are you?
All right, thanks, you?
Yeah, come in here. This is my war room for the last 25-odd years.
So this is where the work really...
But no longer. Sugar is moving out soon because he sold his electronics company Amstrad to Sky. He says he has no regrets.
You can't get too emotional about these things. I mean, I suppose perhaps I'm a heartless person. I don't know. But you think I should be emotional? I should be crying as I walk up the stairs or
well,
sobbing?
I don't think it would be for me to say.
In the 1980s, Sugar drove Amstrad from success in hi-fi to even greater success in computers. They still make electronics here for the satellite television business.
Hello, mate. Busy?
Very busy, yes.
Sugar can visit, but he isn't the boss anymore. Today, most of Sugar's money is in property, over £500 million worth, according to a recent rich list.
I'm told that some of these you just bought sight unseen, is that right?
Sometimes, yeah. Get a piece of paper, a brochure, buy them from a brochure, yeah.
But does it excite you, the investing your money in this being your business, like
Not
Amstrad
really. No,
did?
No. Now, what's the exciting part is buying them and selling them. Holding them is very boring.
Alan Sugar's is a classic rags-to-riches story. He was born in this North London estate. There were already three children in the family when, 12 years on, Faye and Nathan Sugar discovered there was going to be a fourth.
He was my little baby brother. He had big eyes and a corkscrew curl right down the centre. And we used to pull it out. I used to retract. Mopsy, that's what we used to call him. Mopsy.
Nathan Sugar was in the rag trade, but work was unpredictable.
My father was constantly out of work. You know, he was frightened where the next penny's coming from, I should think.
And were you very conscious of the anxieties about money?
Yes, I think I was, yeah.
As a boy, Sugar started earning his own money with a stream of odd jobs.
We had a greengrocer down the road, Charlton's, and Alan used to go there Friday evening and used to boil all the beetroots.
we set up our own beetroot boiling vat in Sugar's garage.
One of the first things was to get this thing, fill it up with water, chuck the beetroots in, set the thing alight, and go off and do all my other tasks. By the time they were finished, this was boiling away. Had to test them out to see whether they're ready or not.
Should we see if one's cooked now?
Yeah.
We've got some, listen, don't pick it out. I've got some tongs here. Oh.
Now you see that one? Yeah, that's done, because its skin is peeling off nicely. So that'll be ready for sale.
Should we try a bit?
There you go. A beautiful beetroot. That's it. Hot beetroot. Lovely smell. Mmm, very nice. Brings me back to the old days. Gordon Ramsay, eat your heart out.
I'm back in the world of Sir Alan, a scene on TV. But this time, it's for real. I'm at a private part of Stansted Airport at 6:30 in the morning. This is Sir Alan's plane, complete with personalised registration.
Do you ever think, I'm Alan Sugar, I used to boil beetroot and work in a grocery shop, but now look at me, I'm on my own private jet?
Yeah, I do.
I mean, this is the way you travel now, isn't it? Do you go to normal airports, Heathrow, and get on a normal plane these days?
No, I mean, if I have to be ashamed of one thing, I'm going to admit that my one luxury that I decided upon is I am never going to stand again in a zoo.
And why do you say if I have to be ashamed of anything?
Well, because, you know, I come from Hackney, from Clapton, and this, that and the other, and I wasn't born with a silver spoon in my mouth, but I don't know, it's just that kind of guilt, if you understand what I mean.
It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard.
After beetroot boiling came a flurry of teenage enterprises. The young Sugar even turned out to be rather a good photographer. But when he left school aged 17, his father insisted he work in the civil service. Sugar hated it and was soon working for a company that sold electrical goods to London shops.
Did you think, when you became a full-time salesman, I've now found my vocation in life?
I felt, I knew that sales was it. That's where I was going to make some money. Sales and what I was selling. Yeah, I was a salesman, yeah.
Soon he was confident enough to quit his job and sell for himself. He's never worked for anyone since. I've been invited to accompany Sugar on a whistle-stop tour of the North. First stop, Manchester.
No problem, just call me on the mobile, I'm on it all day. Yeah?
We're bound for an electronics business Sugar has just bought.
Radio, thanks.
But he made the most important deal of his life when he was just 21. She was called Anne Simons.
Was he romantic? Did he woo you?
No. Alan's definitely not the romantic type. Definitely not. He wasn't the normal run of boys of that age. He was always a bit different.
And what was different about him?
What was different? His manners. There weren't many. He was just very straight. I just wasn't used to that type of thing. But but that's what I liked about him. Don't know why, but I did.
But Anne's parents weren't so keen.
In her parents' mind, I wasn't catching a month. It's the old thing, they would rather have an accountant or a lawyer or a doctor.
They just thought I could do better. I wouldn't say they wouldn't think he was good enough, they just thought I could have done better.
The young couple were married anyway. Thanks to Alan's work and Anne's hairdressing job, they could buy a house, moving up the social ladder to the suburbs in Redbridge. Within a few years, there were three little Sugars, Simon, Daniel and Louise.
What kind of a dad were you?
Today's standards, not good. I didn't saw the kids, really. I was out in the morning at 7 o'clock and back in the evening at 7 o'clock, and they were in bed, so I saw them on the weekends. Yeah,
where I have to say that, you know, I was a bit tired. Didn't give him much time, really.
Sugar felt strongly that the children shouldn't take money for granted.
On Saturday mornings, it was pocket money day, and I had to stand in their bedroom and tell him exactly why I deserved that £5 that week and exactly why he should give it to me. And, you know, and I could see them now, picturing back now, thinking, remembering them laughing, both of them in bed laughing, listening to me, but I was taking it very seriously.
I went to work when I was 16, and my brother the same, and, you know, and we were taught the value of money.
My first job was in McDonald's, working there a couple of times a week.
Did you ever resent that? I mean, as you left your, what must have been pretty palatial home to go and work in the local McDonald's, did you ever think, I wish I didn't have to do this?
No, not really, because it was how we were brought up, and it was, didn't think second about it.
All Sugar's children have worked for him, and both the boys still do. Today, he's visiting a business run by Simon.
Dear, oh dear, oh dear.
It makes advertising screens to go into shops and places like doctors' waiting rooms.
If we're relying upon the cold air being sucked in through here and flowing out through the top...
Sugar is company chairman.
That thing is there.
But he still likes to get into the detail of product design.
Opening those slots up there may be counterproductive.
They need to decide whether to add a protective cover to the advertising screens. Chief Executive Simon Sugar insists they should.
These things are going to last in stores for 5 years. That's my only concern.
In my head, it's always been an absolute non-issue, right?
But the chairman disagrees.
I personally feel that you don't need that piece of plastic. It's going to be counterproductive, and I don't think it's going to cause us any damage.
And he's supported by one of the company staff.
But I do think that the LCDs are clear and they are brighter without the Perspex on.
Sugar comes up with a way of resolving the issue.
Here's what we do, very simple. We take the front panel off, we'll put them in a kind of worst-case environment as if it was in a shop, right? And you decide. Decide. We'll do it downstairs.
Right. You
get a crisper image.
Yeah, it is crisper.
In the end, it was Dad who decided.
I think we should go with that. Honestly, I really do. And I'll I'll take a flyer there and take the responsibility. I don't think we're going to have an after-sales problem, especially if we put a rubber seal around it. Yeah?
OK. I mean, in one sense, it must be lovely to have your family and your business with you. But on the other hand, when you're in front of colleagues and all the rest of it, effectively, you overruled him, didn't you, today? That's what it looked like to me.
I didn't feel that was overruling. I thought he got the same treatment as any other member of staff would have. I thought we concluded by a very logical discussion that we don't need the front on the screen. You know,
even though that's what he wanted.
Yeah, but he's not qualified to want that because, I mean, you saw him listen to an engineer independently. So I think it's unfair of you to try and imply that I kind of just said, no, that's it, I'm doing it my way or not.
I'm not saying that you did that because that would imply you were throwing your toys out of the pram. I don't mean that for a moment, but... And I don't want to make too big a deal out of this, you know, it's not...
You're not doing bad. You
all right,
are,
well,
you are.
No, I don't mean to make too big. I guess
I'll be clear on it. Why does it sit immediately there? Why does it have to sit immediately there?
Sugar's confidence with technology comes from almost 40 years of poking around inside gadgets. Age 21, he'd set up his own company, Amstrad, named after his initials, AMS, to import and sell electrical goods.
And I suppose the next stepping stone was me getting a little bit concerned that all I'm really doing is kind of on a treadmill, really, and nothing there with none of my own intellectual property in the product. It was like me too product. So I wanted to move into manufacturing.
The young Alan Sugar flew to Hong Kong to buy components and set up a production line in London. Result? The cheapest hi-fi equipment on the market. It would have been a game show host's dream.
Presenting the Amstrad 8000 Amplifier. Get ready for the 1970s with Amstrad's exciting new hi-fi experience. With bass and treble controls, mono and stereo outputs and integrated headphone socket, the Amstrad 8000 offers rich harmonics and authentic frequency range. All for just £17.70. Tune into Amstrad today.
Amstrad was profitable. Sugar expanded to bigger premises, near where his family still lived in the East End.
When he got his first factories, we couldn't...
We couldn't comprehend that.
I was just going to use that word.
We couldn't comprehend anything like that in business.
He didn't come from business people. And couldn't believe that Alan is going to have his own factory and people working for him.
We look at this unit.
From amplifiers, the ambitious Sugar went on to make complete hi-fi systems and came up with an ingenious way to compete with the big manufacturers.
The hi-fi industry was made up of you owning a separate amplifier, a separate tuner, and a separate tape deck, yeah? So you had three elements to this thing, and then you went and put it in a wooden rack. And each of those things had its own separate power cord that you had to plug into the wall. And on top of that, not to get too technical, inside those things, there was a lot of duplicated components. And so it dawned upon me one day that if I made an aesthetic look as if you had a separate amplifier and a separate tuner and a separate deck, but had one lump of electronics in the back, there'd be some massive savings. And that's what I did.
Amstrad. Towers. Belt drive. Three-band tuner.
Sugar's tower systems undercut the competition and became Amstrad's first blockbuster product.
£129, £159, £149, £169 or less at these selected stores.
His success in hi-fi allowed Sugar to buy his Essex mansion in 1983.
The heron comes and he sits himself in the middle of the pond like a statue and then stuns them, picks them up and takes them out and has lunch.
The house is still the centre of the Sugar family's world.
Yeah. And do you actually come around much, I guess? You must
I mean, I do, especially now. Not working and the kids. Yeah, quite a lot, yeah.
Mum, providing.
Yeah, absolutely. Babysitting.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Babysitting, yeah.
All the children were brought up here and still live nearby, now with their own families.
When the grandkids are around, it's like a mini Brands Hatch. If they're not recharged, then we're in trouble when they get round here, because one of them... It's got a car that works, the other one hasn't got a car that works, so it's a bit of a kind of a nightmare. I'll leave it to the wife to sort out.
When Amstrad floated on the stock market in 1980, Sugar sold a quarter of his stake for £2 million. He showed his father the cheque.
He said, so many noughts, I just can't believe it. And he phoned me up, because we were living there, I had a telephone, and he says, I don't know what he's going to do with the money. I said, well, Alan will find some. Alan will find a use for it. Don't worry.
£2 million for you and for your father must have been quite a moment.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah, of course it was. But we're not big emotional people, really. I think I get it from my mum and dad. They were kind of quite miserable people. I think it was the hard life that they had, so wouldn't have seen the... ranting on and the emotion of it, like, well, can you believe it? Hey, from where you started? No, you wouldn't get that. My mother would say, very, very nice. Seriously, that's what she would say. Oh, very, very nice. Tea?
Wealth hasn't divided Sugar's family. His brother is a retired taxi driver. He and his sisters haven't asked for handouts.
I think Alan's quite fortunate with us.
No, we don't make demands.
Not a demanding family at all. I do know that...
if anything bad happens to us...
He's always there for us. And you don't have to ask.
He would always take the initiative in finding out the results.
So you haven't got that worry, you see, at the back of your mind.
Financially.
You've got the security. Yeah.
Sugar had made his fortune, aged 33. But the best was yet to come. New products were appearing in the shops called home computers. Sugar wasn't impressed.
There's no rocket science in this computer stuff, right? It's chips, printed circuit boards, lumps of metal, transformers, power cords and cables. That's all it is. And that, I think, is why we were so successful, because of that philosophy. Don't be blinded, don't be sucked in by this mystique of what this hardware is all about. It's nothing special. Nothing special at all.
Sugar dismissed existing home computers as pregnant calculators. His computer would be what he called a mug's eyeful, to include, unusually for the time, its own monitor.
Wouldn't it be nice if your home computer was ready to use as soon as you got it home? And wouldn't it be wonderful if it came with its own green screen or full-color monitor so you didn't have to steal the television to use it? The Amstrad CPC 464, the complete home computer.
Behind the slick marketing image, Amstrad had a rather different face. When Sugar's computer was launched in 1984, the company moved to this no-frills block in Brentwood, Essex.
My heart just sunk when I saw that building, and then when I got up onto the 8th floor and saw the desks, the carpet, the windows, wow. I was really staggered, and I realised this guy was only focused on cost, nothing else.
Thomas Power is an entrepreneur who says he learnt his trade from Alan Sugar. But when he was hired by Amstrad, age 21, he found he'd joined the school of hard knocks.
He sat in the middle and we all sat around the edge in a circle. You're in an environment of terror. It's very intimidating. And there's no respect for what you're doing at all. And, you know, for the first few weeks I thought, what the hell have I done? You know, why have I come here? Am I completely mad?
My desk was here. It wasn't really the middle of the office, but let's say it was about there. And I would look out on the sales and marketing people and administration people.
The young Thomas Power longed for Friday night when he went home to his parents.
I'd get in and I'd explain to my father, you know, how rude he was, how frightening he was, how much he swore at me. And I would, you know, I'd cry and cry and cry in front of my father. Then Sunday night, go back into hell.
And how would you describe yourself as a boss when you were sitting here at your desk?
Very appreciative of efficiency, I think, is the way I'd like to put it.
A lot of people starting the company didn't like the attitude, the aggression, the way the company worked and left. If people stay long enough, they tend to stay for life.
Indeed, I came across some Amstrad lifers who had no complaints.
What's he been like to work for?
It's been an education, a complete education.
It's really nice, actually. Yeah.
Really nice?
Yeah.
Now, that's not a term that we often hear. Well, really nice.
What can I say?
I also met two real live apprentices who are still getting used to Sugar's management style.
Does he shout? What does he do? Come on.
I'm not going to divulge secrets of what goes on. What goes on in the boardroom stays in the boardroom. Just put it this way, the bleep machine would have to be in use.
In full effect.
Thankfully, that's only happened once or twice in the last in 2 years or so.
One aspect of Sugar as an employer that has raised hackles is his views on hiring women. Last year, he criticised equal opportunity laws that prevent employers asking women about their plans to have children or their childcare arrangements. In response, Sugar found himself being called a Wally, an even Neanderthal man.
That started World War II. They hauled out Janet Street Porter, you know.
Don't know what he's talking about, Alan Sugar. He's not an old bleep and should get back in his cave.
You know, that nasal hag. An employer should have the right to ask a lady, do you have any intention of having children? Or if you've got children, how about the looking after them? Is that all sorted?
I cannot tell you how insulted I would be if my employer said to me, I just want to check what your childcare arrangements are. Because I would say, you're hiring me to do a job. I've come forward because I believe I can do the job and I'm professional enough to turn up when I have to, just as my husband, you know, if his mother should fall ill or whatever, things should happen in his life, which you're not saying you would ask about.
Your simple answer
You would assume that he's professional enough too?
Your simple answer to that is my childcare arrangements are perfect, they're fine. It's not going to affect my job.
Well, my answer would be it's none of your business, actually.
I'm sick and tired of discussing this subject of women because I am right, absolutely right, and 99% of the women agree with me. Apart from Janet Street Porter, and it appears you also. So you're in good company. Although you're much prettier than her, of course.
Yeah. Sugar has appointed women to senior positions in Amstrad, but his peers aren't surprised he's attracted controversy.
Alan is not a man who is politically correct, to put it mildly. He starts off by having views, and those views tend to be embedded in cement on his relationships. And I won't go through his views, because you can find them out yourself. But some of his views, I think, go back to the Stone Age.
It was on another flight years ago that Sugar sketched the idea for the product that would make his name.
Amstrad's revolutionary new word processor, the PCW-A256, takes typing into the 1980s. Make corrections on screen before you print. Store documents on disk to be edited later. And send out personalized mail to all your contacts with one program. The PCW is truly a breakthrough for home and business.
The first Amstrad word processor was extraordinarily successful, one of the most successful, outstanding launches of any new product we had. It just walked off the shelf. So we sold our first 10,000 almost instantly and were screaming for more and more.
The electrical goods chain Dixon's became Amstrad's most important customer.
Overnight, the market expanded, and as a result of which, people like ourselves in the electrical business went into computers in depth and became actually the main outlet for the big consumer market in home computers, driven by Alan's word processor.
The Amstrad 8256, more than a word processor, for less than most typewriters.
By 1987, the success of his word processors had made Alan Sugar the 15th richest man in Britain.
That's all right, isn't it?
That's it. Microphone's like that.
Worth an estimated £600 million, he'd acquired a millionaire's hobby.
Your navigator, oh, chief navigator.
Really don't want...
That way up. We're here.
Oh, my God.
Here over there, there's no one on the approach.
Sugar used to fly himself from Essex to his assembly plants around England.
And we're ready to go. We're on.
Up we go.
Traffic. Ain't no notice for them.
With wealth came fame.
He's been called the Arthur Daly of the computer world. He prefers to be known as its Henry Ford. Welcome the founder of Amstrad, Alan Sugar.
And here we are.
Oh, look at that. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
Now it was my turn.
I'll just get the thing set up nicely and see if I can give you your wings. So put your feet on the rudders.
Are you sure this is safe?
Oh, don't worry. You'll be all right.
We've been active in making computers, believe it or not, only for about 3 or 4 years. And even though we have the world or the European market tied up, it's quite an amazing achievement, if I say so myself.
Yeah.
Just hold that stick then.
Sugar has never lacked confidence. But by the late 1980s, it seemed there was nothing he couldn't do.
Look how light it is, you see? That action pulls us back. And this one pushes us down. No, it's really nothing, look. So, there you go, you have control.
Oh my God, it's going down. How do I stop it going
just
down?
Slightly back, pull back slightly.
I am rigid with tension.
No, you shouldn't be, you must hold it nice and lightly. Pull back a little bit.
Yeah.
Little movements.
You're a very gentle teacher. Not what I was expecting.
You must, everything in flying has to be very, 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 very slow movements and all that stuff. Now, where's the airfield then?
Amstrad was now selling across Europe, as well as on British high streets. There, the relationship between Dixon's and Amstrad's boss was a battle.
He would write the most violently aggressive letters to us, telling us that our demands were unreasonable, etc. and so forth. He didn't believe in the principle of building up goodwill.
As Sugar saw it, Dixon's was taking a slice of his profits. He used to refer to them as one of those arsehole retailers.
I think I probably responded by saying that's only because we have to sell the crap that you're making.
Sugar developed a new computer for the lucrative business market, taking on the world leader, IBM.
The Amstrad PC 1512. Compatible with you-know-who. Priced as only we know how.
But long-term business clients expected ever more sophisticated technology, putting a strain on Sugar's lean and mean organisation.
Amstrad, the personal computer and video group, has seen a sharp fall in its half-yearly profits. They were down by £15 million. The chairman, Alan Sugar, admitted the company had made mistakes.
We expanded too quickly and we screwed up. We didn't have enough engineering, enough understanding of the technology as it got more complex. I take total responsibility for that. It's no one else's fault.
Thousands of customers reported problems with a new range of business computers, forcing Sugar to recall the lot. It turned out to be a fault in the hard drives supplied to Amstrad.
The way we used to buy hard drives, we did no qualification of the product and did no qualification of the drive other than getting one, sticking it in, making sure it worked, assuming that these giant companies that made hard drives knew more than us.
There is a sort of slight tragedy in the Amstrad computer brand. At one time it just dominated our shelves. It was Amstrad, Amstrad, Amstrad. But then he started to expand the range and he ran into certain technical problems. And his goodwill with us was very fragile. And we were always looking for new brands to stock. And in due course, that process started. So this great brand, Amstrad, started to become not the number one seller.
It dealt a very deep wound to Amstrad, from which really it never recovered. Had that not happened, I think Amstrad today would be a huge company. But we were killed. We were killed by those component manufacturers.
Years later, Sugar won compensation in court for the faulty drives. But the damage to Amstrad's reputation in the business market was done.
He was really emotionally terribly affected by it. And it was the first sort of thing that had happened that had sort of really hurt him, you know, really stopped the company's tracks in a way. So yes, he was very deeply affected by it.
Whatever his problems at work, Sugar had made enough money to cheer himself up with long holidays in the sun. Today, he's got a home in Florida and another here in Marbella in Spain.
Hello, how are you?
So this is the courtyard.
Yeah, this is a typical Spanish courtyard.
This is gorgeous.
Lounge, and we've got the statutory large plasma screen.
Yep, room to hang out with your friends.
Yeah, grandchildren, kids. And you've got the sea.
And the pool. So how much time in the year do you spend here?
Well, it varies. You know, you can have a week here, a week back home, or in the summer I might spend 2 weeks here.
Is it quite a bit then?
Yeah, it can be. It can be.
Get much use out of the pool?
I don't like swimming. I could maybe just save my life if I had to, but I've never been able to swim properly.
And don't you ever think, I mean, you don't need to get back to work, do you, financially? Don't you ever think, this is so nice, I'll just hang out here?
No way would I live here in Spain.
Really? I must say, I'd be tempted to think, hello, Marbella, goodbye, Chigwell.
Not in a million years. Never. I mean, it's very nice while the sun's shining and all that stuff. You don't want to be here when the sun's not shining, because there's absolutely nothing to do, nowhere to go, and that's it. So it's good for the sun.
Even at the height of his success, Sugar always put aside holidays, evenings and weekends for family life. And that was a different world, run by Anne.
Thanks a lot.
Did you discuss business with her when you come home?
No, because I guess that I knew that she would not have anything to offer me other than telling me to stop worrying. That's about it.
The minute he walks through the door, I've only got to look at his face and I know whether he's had a bad day or a good day. And I know when he's had a bad day, I just never pestered him or asked him any questions. I knew when he was ready to talk, he would talk. But I never, ever knew much about the actual running of the business or anything like that.
The Sugars had long been fans of their local team, Spurs. When it hit financial trouble in the 80s, Sugar suddenly stepped in.
What on earth made you decide to buy Tottenham Hotspur?
I don't know. I happen to know Terry Venables, who was the manager at the time, so I just picked up the phone to ask to speak to him, knowing that he was kind of put together some consortium of some kind, and that's it. Mad, no?
Anne Sugar was used to not being told about her husband's work, but this time, even she was shocked.
He just came home one day and said to me, I've bought Tottenham Hotspur. I went mad. And it was just unbelievable how fast it all happened.
And did you not say, darling, you might have told me just a little bit about your plans?
No, because that was typical Alan. That is Alan.
What do you think of the proposition that hard-headed businessmen, who are tremendously shrewd and sharp, when they go into show business or when they go into something like football, they seem to lose their marbles, don't they? They seem to lose all good sense.
Yeah, I heard that. I heard that. And I've been warned of that by some very good friends. And that's really... I think the thing going for me is I'm not a football fanatic.
When he took on Spurs and went in on the first day, he had a nasty surprise. Because I think he found now that he was now moving with people from an entirely different world.
Let me just quote one thing you said about footballers. You said they don't know what honesty or loyalty is. They're the biggest scum that walk on this planet. Hmm. Is that really what you think?
Yeah. Not all of them. Can I say what you're doing is you're doing a Daily Mail here, aren't you? You've read it from a newspaper, right? You picked it up from a newspaper.
Get over it. I'm using it merely as a prompt to say.
No, you picked it up from a newspaper, and the newspaper conveniently dropped.
If I can get a word in edge, tell me in your own words then what you think of football players.
I think that most of them are selfish, self-centred. You know, people who only care about themselves, they don't give a damn about their football clubs, they're mercenaries. Some of them are scumbags of the lowest order that if they weren't in football, might be in prison. Some of them, yeah.
Handling the footballers themselves was supposed to be Terry Venables' job. He'd been appointed chief executive. But that meant he also had a hand in running the business. And that led to trouble with Sugar, the chairman.
Well, I think that Terry, in hindsight, must have thought, there's this rich bloke coming along, wants to own a football club. And so if you think that, then you can also think, stick him in the corner, give him a couple of seats there, let him have go to the boardroom for lunch every day, and that'd be it. He'd be happy. Give us the money and off we go.
Venables knew the football game very well, and Sugar felt he wasn't kept properly informed as the chairman as to how the club was being run, how football was being run.
After 2 years, Sugar sacked Venables, and all hell broke loose.
The fans who thought he was Tottenham Hotspur vented their outrage at a decision which still has no official explanation.
I think I can speak on behalf of the rest of the players and say we're not happy. I haven't actually spoke to him, but I know that's going to be the feeling in the camp.
What I didn't realise was that in football terms, I had shot Bambi. Every single gutter journalist, every single back page journalist was his mate. They all used to go drinking down his club. I had no chance whatsoever.
Venables appealed against his sacking in the High Court, but outside, the chairman's name was mud.
What he didn't expect was the sort of personal abuse. People spitting at him in the street, shouting abuse at him, breaking into his garage and scratching obscenities on his cars. I remember in the High Court somebody leaning over a balustrade and spitting on his head. It was disgusting.
The court supported Sugar in his decision to get rid of Venables, making fans even more angry.
You'd turn up for work on the Monday and, you know, there'd be a pile this deep of letters for him telling him, you know, how they're going to kill him.
We used to have people outside the house holding banners up, and it was just awful. And it was awful for the kids to see as well.
I found it very hard to deal with that he got such bad press and, you know, for stuff that was completely outside of his control.
And I just kept saying to Alan, why did you get involved in this world? It was just awful.
Even with Venables gone, Sugar still got a bad press. Not unusual for a chairman of a struggling club.
Skillful managers, and most of them are quite skillful at working the press, will suggest that the fault is not with them. The fault is higher up in the food chain, and the chairman, probably money is not being provided. They won't put it directly, but they'll talk about the club's ambitions or not having the right players in the right positions and so on. And the press will get the idea, and the fans will get the idea, which is important, is that the chairman hasn't opened his chequebook. Open your chequebook, then is the cry.
Sugar's patience ran out when an article in the Daily Mail accused him of being a miser in not providing more money to buy players. He sued for libel and wept in court when giving evidence.
Absolute frustration brought me to tears. Total frustration when you've got, in the courtroom, sitting along the back there, you've got vultures. Vultures with their pens out, all from the back pages of the newspaper.
Again, Sugar won his case. He gave the £100,000 he was awarded to charity. And a decade after entering football, he sold up. He'd made over £20 million. But that couldn't make up for the price he'd paid in the rest of his business life.
Tottenham Hotspur Football Club was a very, very bad move for me, for Alan Sugar PLC. Very bad move. And a very, very bad move for Amstrad PLC. Because what it also shows is a weakness in me, in that I am a one-trick pony. So when I took my eye off the ball and went to Tottenham, I wasted 10 years of my life in that nonsense and took my eye off the ball here.
So what had been happening at Amstrad? Well, a few years into Sugar's decade at Tottenham, the company was in trouble.
To business journalists, Amstrad was once hot copy. Blockbuster products generated blockbuster profits. But after losing over £100 million, the company is barely back into the black. Amstrad just isn't exciting anymore. It seems to have lost its way.
To make things worse, Sugar had lost his touch with consumer products, many of which just didn't sell.
Make beautiful music with Amstrad's new keyboard. Featuring easy play mode for non-musicians. Ladies, Amstrad brings technology to your bodies with the Integra Body Skate, the massage system that responds to your needs. Abdomen, thighs, or back, you choose where the Amstrad works its magic. Feels good, doesn't it?
In the 80s, you seen the man who knew what the customer wanted. In the 90s, that seemed to have deserted you.
Yeah, I think it's a fair comment. Although there was an air of panic of wanting to come out with products that sold a million in the first week, and lack of patience on my behalf.
There were plenty of new lines, some even ahead of their time, but none turned into a blockbuster.
Amstrad's NC100 notepad computer travels with you and says you mean business.
Sugar had made his fortune when Mrs. Thatcher was in power. He was happy to be a symbol of her new egalitarian world.
We were Labour supporters, or my father was Labour supporters all their life, but Thatcher, she came in, she was a breath of fresh air, really. I remember all the Hooray Henrys in the city. They kind of got kicked to one side. I mean, there was Charlie, if he was good at mathematics and economics or whatever, with his Cockney accent, he could go and work in the city, right? That was a massive change.
Alan, how are you? Great to see you. Great to see you. Thanks for coming to school.
But just before Labour won power, Sugar switched sides.
We will do better. The purpose of this nationwide tour, and starting here today, is to give everybody the chance to do better.
Sugar took part in government events to promote business.
He's a huge influence on people. If people think, I want to be a business person, I want to be an entrepreneur, I want to start a company, they'll think of Alan Sugar amongst very few other people in the country that they look to as role models.
To introduce to you...
Sugar has also been an advisor on government committees, though he has reservations about some who served alongside him.
They start lecturing about things which I'm either thick or intellectually beneath them and don't understand what they're talking about, or they're just bloody boring.
It's when he says, that's a useless idea. You remember that?
And he even says that to you?
You'd say it to anybody, you'd say it to me. And I think one of the good things about Alan is you can test your ideas with him and he'll give you a pretty blunt response.
Sugar's straight talking, success in business and donations to charity were eventually recognised.
One morning he came down to my office and closed the door and he walked round behind me and he just said, look, Bob, I'm going to tell you something now that... I can't tell anybody else. Only N knows. So I'm thinking he's going to tell me he's going to die, he's got some illness or something like this. And he said, I'm going to be knighted.
Arise, Sir Alan.
I think I deserved it, to be honest with you. I'm not being, you know, I'm not being big-headed about it. I was... an example of someone who came out of the council flats and then built himself up a business, didn't rob a bank. It was, you know, real make stuff, sell stuff, get paid for it.
I was working at the time in the office and he was Mr. Sugar the whole time in the office to everyone, or Alan, and he had to send an email around to say to people, right, OK, this is new now, this is new for me as well, but it's not Mr. Sugar anymore, it's Sir Alan. And those of you who already call me Alan, you continue calling me Alan, but those of you Mr. Sugar... he's changed to Sir Alan. It was a big change. It was a big change for everybody, and
so
even
that came
for us
to him.
Hear.
He wanted people to call him
yes,
Sir Alan.
Yeah, he did. He did. I think he was proud of it. And why not?
Louise was telling us he sent a memo around at work saying, I'm Sir Alan now, and that's kind of what you need to call me now.
I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised.
Most of your employees call you Sir Alan.
Is that because that's what you... No, he doesn't. Alan, he doesn't.
Do you insist on that?
Not at all. Ivor calls me Alan, Cliff calls me Alan.
Because in The Apprentice it's all Sir Alan, isn't it?
Yeah, that is, but not here.
So am I allowed to call you Alan then?
You can, if you want to. For a fee.
After a string of disappointments in the consumer market, Sugar pinned his hopes on another Amstrad innovation.
Amstrad brings the modern world to the heart of your home with its revolutionary emailer phone. While the screen brings you the latest offers, the emailer comes complete with its own keyboard. Without the fuss of a computer, the emailer keeps you in touch through your own Amstrad account. And its stylish looks are an asset to any living room.
Almost 500,000 were sold, but the emailer wasn't an Amstrad blockbuster.
People didn't like paying for sending an email. It was as simple as that. So perhaps we were a couple of years too late with this product, maybe 2 years earlier, then everyone would have had one, and, you know.
After decades of risky product launches, Sugar has built up enough of his own wealth not to worry too much anymore. These days, he's not tied to the office. He can work from anywhere, including from his villa in Spain. He can indulge in his new hobby, which friends say he's almost as fanatical about as he once was about flying. There have been plenty of disappointments in electronics for Sugar, but one line of work has gone from strength to strength. Based in New York, News Corporation is Rupert Murdoch's media empire. In 1988, Murdoch wanted to launch a satellite service. He asked Sugar to make the dishes for the new Sky television.
Alan discussed how he could make large quantities at a reasonable price. He believed in simplicity, and he believed in speed and delivery and low price. So it suited us all around.
Our approach was, what is the dish? And we had a look at it, and it was reminiscent to a dustbin lid. So we went to the equivalent of, say, a dustbin lid basher, and said, what does a dustbin lid cost to bash out? And we got made for a quid.
For a quid?
Yeah. The actual raw dish was made for a quid, yeah.
We are seeing, I think, the dawn of an age of freedom for viewing and freedom for advertising.
2 months after Murdoch had approached Sugar, they held a joint launch for the new service.
The Amstrad group today announced it's getting in on the act with a small satellite dish the size of an umbrella, costing just under £200.
The satellite receiver business became a mainstay for Amstrad, while other products declined. By last year, it was about all that was left.
I wonder if ultimately was it a bit disappointing for you that Amstrad should end up relying so much on the satellite business, which didn't really capture the imagination the way that those products did in the 80s.
Yeah, I think that's a valid point. I think it's a valid point to say that it was a bit frustrating to have lost effectively 30%, 40% of the PC market. But that's me, you see, I'm realistic. I mean, what can you do? You can't keep crying in your beer. The thing that was actually bringing big revenues to us was satellite, so we got on with it.
Amstrad, one of the pioneers of the computer revolution, is being bought by BSkyB for £125 million.
Last year, Sugar sold his company to its biggest customer. £125 million may sound like a lot of money, but it was just 10% of what Amstrad was worth at its peak.
Why did you buy Amstrad last year?
Two reasons. One, it was a good profitable company. And secondly, we wanted to get control completely on the design of our boxes. We've got our own, you know, major R&D facilities now.
To Murdoch, Amstrad looked like a good investment. But within his massive media empire, it'll now be just, well, a small satellite.
This was a total disaster. You're fired.
He may have lost Amstrad, but today, Sir Alan is almost a brand in himself through the success of the BBC's Apprentice series. He's proud of it, but claims he's different from his TV persona.
The problem is with you television people is that you believe what you see on TV.
Well, that's because I see you on TV.
And that's and what you don't see, and what how do you put it, all you people in the television business, you don't see the cuttings on the cutting room floor, because the stuff on the cutting room floor is no good for the programme.
So are you telling me you're cuddly, really?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that if you really saw all what they filmed, it would disappoint the producers of The Apprentice, because what they want to see is this all the time, you see, and I've just dropped all the egg over me. That's what they want to see, to which...
Yeah, but you're the one that's giving it to them.
No, I don't.
No one's
I
making
anymore.
You say that stuff.
I don't anymore.
But those close to him don't share his view.
Everyone keeps saying to me, is Alan really like him that, or has he got a script? And I said, that what you see... Once you know him now, once you see him, that is Alan.
That's the real Alan.
The real
Sugar.
Alan Sugar. Yeah, it is.
He is exactly as you see him on The Apprentice. We may sometimes miss the twinkle in his eye, but that's it. No, he's absolutely right. Absolutely the same.
The only complaint about The Apprentice from Sugar's family comes from his older sister, Shirley, and it's about him.
I know Alan's got a temper because we've all got the Sugar temper, but the language, I never heard him swear. And I just could not believe it was Alan swearing. So I phoned him up and said, Alan, please moderate your language.
She's getting very old, Shirley. She's getting very, very old. I mean, any viewer of The Apprentice will know that I made a deliberate decision never to swear on that programme.
Bloody, bloody pillar.
Minor expletives, maybe.
Bloody, bloody, bloody cheddar cheese.
Sugar is not one to let criticism pass, even from his sister.
She never phoned me to say that. It may be when she's down at the Ladies Vittler's Society, she sits and talks with all of her friends there saying, oh, I saw your brother on television. Yes, I told him off. Actually, the other day, I think she made it up, really.
And I'm afraid it hasn't improved. His language hasn't improved. I haven't phoned him up since.
Last year, Sugar put on a spectacular show in his enormous garden to celebrate his 40th wedding anniversary. For once, his business and family life came together. At the party, Sugar paid tribute to the shy girl he'd courted four decades ago.
Anne always says that the day she met me, she knew she had met Mr. Wright. What she didn't know, my first name was Always.
Alan hates parties when they're in his honour, but I think he agreed to this one as it was for both of us. And for him, he was very good at the party.
What do you mean
he
for him?
He smiled a lot. Everyone was saying, God, he's smiling a lot. I mean, all our close friends were going, God, I haven't seen him smile like that for ages. So he did enjoy it.
But that's not normally his kind of thing.
No, no.
Anne got her way on the party, but then she was owed one. After a notorious incident that neither of them has forgotten. One birthday, she received a card from her husband signed, Best Wishes, Alan Sugar.
I don't know, just one of those things. I signed my name, Alan Sugar. Very rarely sign it Alan. But I will, you know, that's something I've done wrong, sorry. That will stick with me forever, that's so. You remember the time you did that? So there you are. That's why I keep her away from newspapers and television cameras, so she can't tell the story anymore.
How did you react to that?
Oh, I went mad. I was furious with him. Absolutely furious. Yeah, but it was a true story.
What did you say to him?
Oh, I can't remember the exact... Well, he knew I was very annoyed. And I got all roses, and he felt sick. When he realised what had happened, he just felt terrible.
So who is the real Alan Sugar? Well, behind the enormous wealth and the what you see is what you get image is a highly successful businessman who admits to his share of mistakes and personal failings.
Look, I know my bad sides. I'm pretty short with people, can sometimes be quite hurtful in what I say and all that type of stuff. And that's my temper. That's my lack of patience and, you know, can't help that. Might be getting a bit better lately, though. Could be getting a bit better as I get a bit older. You'd have to ask the wife that, what she thinks.
Because after all, we're here really to celebrate the union of a great couple of people.
Over 40 years, their traditional marriage has protected Anne from the worst stresses of her husband's business life. And his prudence, taking money from the electronics business and putting it into property, has paid off handsomely.
Could you ever have imagined
no,
that you'd have not the wealth that you
no,
do now?
No. I just thought that we'd just be an ordinary, everyday family. I just didn't dream it would happen, what has happened.
Filming with Sugar, I found he's still in a hurry, still curious, and yes, often still a prickly, uncomfortable character. But then, that's the drive that produced all this.
BBC2 City Season continues with a new series in which eight novices are given $1 million, 2 weeks of training and 2 months to see if they can make a killing running their own hedge fund. Million Dollar Traders begins tomorrow at 9 o'clock.
Bye!